Hello, my name is Leendert Molendijk. I'm a hematologist at Applied Research of Wageningen University in the Netherlands. It's a pleasure to introduce you into the world beneath your feet. There is really a lot to discover, a world to discover. In this contribution, I will tell about the nematodes, these little tiny worms living in the soil.
The outline of this presentation is a short introduction on nematodes and its diversity. Then I will focus on the nematode species that are really a headache for farmers, to end with a systematic approach which makes it possible to live together with everything that's active in the ground as a grower without worries. So every hand of soil contains thousands of nematodes. They are important for many soil processes. They are quite different. Some of them are only 1/1000th of a millimeter or even smaller. And the largest one are the nematodes in Wales, which can be longer than 8 meters. The plant parasitic nematodes, worldwide we have over 100 species. But on the total of the nematode life, they are really the exception on the rule. In Europe, we have to cope with 30 up to 50 important species. How is it possible so little is known about nematodes? Nematodes are everywhere where it's water. Most of them are found in the marine sediments, and 25% are living in water, in freshwater and freshwater sediments. The animal and human parasitic nematodes can cause atrocities like the elephantiasis, which is shown on the photo right under. 10% of the global food production is lost because of plant parasitic nematodes. These 10%, they are typically because they have a thorn in the head with which they are able to rip their cell walls and to attack plants. On the more heavy soils, the most important groups are the cyst nematodes, the spiral nematodes and the stem nematodes. On the light soils, these species are there, but also a lot of other species like the root knot, the root lesion, the trigodorus, the xiphenema and the longidorus. So the lighter the soil, the more species can live in it. Nematodes are washed out of the soil by bringing the samples into an elutriator. The water current separates the nematodes from the soil particles. The soil moves to the bottom and the nematodes stay floating in the water, which is sieves to get the nematodes out. The left one on the picture is an Oosterbrink elutriator to process samples for free living nematodes. The right one is a Seinhorst to collect cysts. Another method often used is sugar flotation. The soil sample is brought into a sugar solution with a density that nematodes make float and soil particles sink. Centrifugation accelerates the separation of nematodes and soil particles. After elutriation and sieving, a clean suspension can be diagnosed beneath the microscope. This is what you see at the magnification of 25 up till 40 to see what species are there. 1200 different species can be found in the soil samples, and mostly there are 30 up till 40 species present, and there's a big separation between the species. Some of them are ectoparasites like the trigodorids, at the left, they stay outside the roots, and others are entering the root cells and are most of the time within the root system. They are the endoparasites. This is a root lesion nematode moving from cell to cell, a real endoparasite. Nematodes can cause direct damage by lower yields or complete loss of quality. You don't see it above ground, but you can't sell the crop anymore. And in the case of quarantine organisms, there is a prohibition of export of the planting material. At the left, you see interaction of nematodes with fungi, in this case Pratelengus penetrans with Verticillium Daliae, causing early wilt of potato. At the right, it's tobacco retrovirus, which is transmitted by trichodorids and causing corky ring spot or spraying in potato. Now I will introduce some important groups of nematodes. One of these is the group of the cyst nematodes. Examples are the potato cyst nematode, sugar beet cyst nematode, carrot cyst nematode, wheat set cyst nematode. And what is striking is that the name of the crop is a part of the name of the nematode species. These nematodes are highly specialized and only live on one of some crops of the same family. A cyst is a dead female that has laid the eggs inside her body. Thus, in this way, the offspring is well protected and can survive for many years. You see the cysts at the right, and at the bottom of the right, you see a pressed cyst, where the eggs and the juveniles inside the eggs are already visible. At the left, you can see what happens when the infestation is growing out of hand, a complete crop failure of potatoes when the populations are far too high. In this slide, more in detail, a cyst, eggs coming out, and you see the juvenile already ready to hatch from the eggs, waiting for the host crop passing by. The same above ground symptoms for onion. The roots seem stubby, and the English name for the species is therefore the stubby root nematode. The forking of carrots caused by Trichodorus primitivus. Because of the superficial growth, no real taproot is produced. Potato cultivar Seresta showing the cell death the TRV, the tobacco retrovirus, is causing. A complete other type of nematode is the stem nematode. This species, Dytelengus dipsisi, is not affecting roots but lives most of the time above ground. Stem nematodes cause misformation of the holm and tubers in onions and shallots, and the leaves remain small, stocky, brittle, and have a bluish color. The bulbs themselves are often vose and cracked, and in case of heavy infestations, plants fall away. This species is also transmitted with seeds of lucerne, onion, and leguminosae, and also in potato tubers. In the root of sugar beets, stem nematode causes twisted petioles and swollen, deformed leaves that are reminiscent of growth damage. The beetroot's head is affected much more, often later in the season. Many more examples of plant parasitic nematode species and the symptoms they cause can be given. In the nematode database, the most important nematode species for edible crops can be found. Important is to develop a nematode control strategy or an integrated nematode management approach, which is tailor-made for a farmer's field. These are the four pillars of such an integrated nematode management approach: prevention, inventory, crop rotation, and targeted control. To avoid the settlement of a nematode species is the best way to stay out of trouble. But this needs awareness of the farmer and their own advice. Clean planting material is a prerequisite. In potato tubers, egg masses of chitwoodi and Miludogyne phalax can be deposited. In case of heavy infestation, this can already be seen at the outside because these tubers have a blemished and bumpy appearance. In case of a light infestation, there is nothing to see on the outside of the tuber yet. When these tubers are peeled, there are still egg masses under the skin. The fact that M. chitwoodi and phalax pass over with the plant and seed potatoes has resulted in both nematodes having a quarantine status. In particular, seed potatoes, dahlia, gladioli are potential sources of the infection. The quarantine status means that all basic material, such as seed potatoes, leek, cabbage, asparagus, dahlia and gladiolus, must comply with the EU Plant Health Directive and be visually free from these nematodes. If a lot is infected, it cannot be marketed as propagating material. As a farmer, you should be aware of the risk. Soil transport by wind is a way to contaminate large areas. Also, by irrigation, introduction of nematodes is possible. Adhering soil or machinery or planting material is a way of dispersal. And as dealt with above, infested planting material is a threat. Maize is a poor host for Miludogyne phalax, but weeds destroy the effect of a sound crop rotation. So weed control is nematode control and part of the prevention. The next pillar is the inventory. To know what is already present in the field is the starting point of the development of an integrated nematode management. Historical information helps. This is Trigodora damage in the field in the 50s of the last century. This spot is still there. So historical information can be very helpful. Once an infestation has taken place, it does not go away. Trigodora damage mainly occurs around the emergence of the crops, especially when it is cold and a humid spring. Damage can be reduced by sowing only when conditions are favorable for rapid start of the growth. So much nematode information is growing in the field and it is available for free. We developed for potato cyst nematodes and Miludogyne sampling methods used by routine laboratories. In this picture, scientific sampling to develop models to optimize sampling grids and sample volumes is taking place. Also at harvest, a lot of nematode information can be gathered. Left the symptoms of Miludogyne haplea, Miludogyne chitwoodi and phalax cannot be distinguished and show the same symptoms as in the photos on the right. But seeing this kind of symptoms at harvest, you know what's going on in that field. Crop rotation plays an important role in the integrated nematode management. It's about the sequence of the crop, the selection of the varieties, the frequency of the crop, and not to forget the green manures, because they are also hosts or non-hosts of the nematode species present. Nematode control starts with a clever rotation, and if available, resistant varieties can be very important to solve the problem. And the chemical and not chemical control, that is the last pillar that is to be used as a safety net and not as a starting point of a control strategy. Here an example. White mustard is a bad choice as a preceding green manure crop in the case of an infestation with Trigodora similis, when black salsify is your next crop. Chemical soil fumigation with 300 liter monam and the anaerobic soil disinfestation proved to give good control and can be used as a safety net. This is an example of an experimental field to establish the host status of different crops, and they are presented in the nematode scheme which can be found at the databases of Best for Soil. When the cropping sequence, choice of cultivar, choice of green manure has been optimized, in some cases extra control is still necessary. Tagetes spatula, marigold, has proven to give long-term control of root lesion nematodes, Pratelengus penetrans. This is used by farmers in the Netherlands in the production of roses, strawberries, lilies and potatoes on the sandy soils. Inundation or flooding is traditionally used in flower bulb production in the west of the Netherlands to control stem nematodes. Nowadays, it's used more and more in other regions, also to control potato cyst nematodes and root nematodes Chitwoody and Phalax. In the case fields are not flat or the water table is too deep, anaerobic soil disinfection can be organized by working in fresh grass, 40 tons per hectare, and covering it with FIF, virtually impermeable foil. In this case, also a good control of nematodes can be realized. Integrated nematode management is not one solution fits all. It's a tailor-made approach that, when implemented successfully, makes it possible that farmers and nematodes live peacefully together without being bothered by each other. The pathogen and nematode scheme offered by Best for Soil in 22 languages are a great tool to develop your own clever crop rotation. In another contribution during this workshop, you will be informed in detail how to make your own schedules and how to use them on your farm. I hope you have enjoyed this contribution. Nematodes in most of the cases are our friends. We just have to control the bad guys, and that's where we have to develop our own integrated nematode management strategy. I wish you much success with doing so.